Ladies and gentlemen, everyone, welcome back to this, which is the closing session for this first day. I'm sure that you found the panel discussions stimulating. I managed to get to three of them all together: universal healthcare, patient safety, dementia. And what I noticed in the limited time I had to see that was the combination of erudition from a whole range of skills and perspectives, combined with a real passion to find ways through. And they were all about the challenges that are being faced. And I noticed in a couple of them, particularly in patient safety, there was a very powerful contribution from one of the panelists, who's a British academic, whose son, Kevin, died in hospital unnecessarily. And yet she brought to that an awareness which the panel picked up on, and I'm sure the everyone else said it in due course, that it's no good just sort of beating the person responsible over the head. You have to try and find ways of improving that delivery of safety for patients. So it was both combined passion and very moving and high level of serious debate. The other was in dementia, which, as we've already heard, is one of the huge and growing global challenges that we face. And there, I was struck by different voices that said, effectively, trying to get finance ministers to spend even a minute with their eyes open while you talk to them about health, let alone about dementia, is a near impossibility. And that made me think, I have to say, in personal terms, you look at all these health challenges. We know that we have to deliver universal health care that is effective. The universal health care panel, incidentally, not surprise, surprise, not one hand went up and said he didn't favor universal health care when Stephen Sacker asked. It made me think, these finance ministers, one of the things we have to do is to instruct rulers, instruct governments, guide, steer, encourage them to say, finance ministers are agents of the world we want to create. They aren't the arbiters of the world we want to create. Too often, personally, it seems to me that the cart is somewhat before the horse. There were also, there's been a lot of tweeting, so I thought I'd just pick up one or two of them. This is the, on mental health care, that session. Rather picking up slightly on what I said before, I suppose. This is from Dina, who tweeted, to tackle stigma towards children with mental health issues, we have to educate adults. Someone quoting Professor Richard Layard in the same session, Sherry Ferrugia doing that, saying, him pointing out, depression kills more people than smoking. On diabetes, Hannah Brinsden said, 300 new diabetes diagnoses every 10 minutes. That's shocking stuff. And someone else, it takes one back to almost where we began. Prajit tweeted, inspired by our keynote speech from Don Berwick, and someone else quoting him, I think more or less precisely accurately, let us make a majestic and powerful engine of human learning and progress. So with that, it's my pleasure to introduce us to our last keynote speaker of this day. Mark Bertolini has unique insight into the healthcare system from both a professional and a personal perspective. As president and CEO of Aetna, Mark's been actively involved in the debate around healthcare reform, advocating increased access and lower cost to improve outcomes. He's also experienced, which is why it's personal, of course, healthcare system firsthand, as a patient after a skiing accident resulted in him having a serious spinal cord injury. His experience behind the desk of one of the largest healthcare benefits companies in the world, as well as on the front lines of patient care, has given Mark a unique perspective into the future of healthcare. Would you welcome, please, Mark Bertolini to the stage?
Thank you, Jonathan. Good afternoon. I understand I'm between you and going on to whatever you want to do next. But I hope I can create some provoking thoughts for you as you think about what we can do as a group to change the healthcare systems of the future. But first, I want to thank Your Highness Sheikh Moza bin Nasser and Professor the Lord Darzi for inviting me here. I'm humbled by the invitation, but I'm very grateful to be able to speak to this group. I speak on this issue around the world, and often I come away with the impression that because of our entrenched economic and political interests in the United States, that health reform and system reform will occur here in the Middle East before it'll happen there. And so I think that's your opportunity. You don't have those entrenched economic and political interests. You have a real opportunity to do it right. And what I want to do is make the case for why it needs to be different, and I want to talk about how we could shape that system for the future. So up on the slide, we have the mission of our organization, but I think a redefinition of how we define health. So our healthcare systems around the world are built to combat sickness, to cure disease. But it really should be about creating healthier individuals. And here's the logic. A healthy individual, community, or nation is more productive and therefore more economically and socially viable and therefore happier. And unless you design where you want your system to go, what you want its outcome to be, any system will do. And I can tell you after decades of dealing with the system in the United States, our costs are out of control, our population isn't any healthier, and our life expectancy is a little bit longer than that of nations like China. So we really haven't accomplished creating healthier individuals who are productive, viable, and happy. And if we build a system like that, it would look very different than the system we have built in the Western democracies. So I have a couple of pictures here for you. The picture on the right is the Gram stain slide of T-cell gamma delta lymphoma. In December 1st, 2001, my 16-year-old son was the 48th known case of this disease anywhere in the world. And I was told he had 6 months left to live because they tried everything and it didn't work. The picture on the left, 3 years later, was how I was evacuated from a ski mountain in Vermont after hitting a tree and breaking my neck at C2, C3, C5, C6, and T1. Now, how am I standing here in front of you and not in a wheelchair or even worse, in a coma? Well, what happened was I fell into deep snow and ice down a cliff and laid there for 2 hours and my spinal cord froze and it didn't expand and I lived to fight another day. Woke up 7 days later from a coma to discover I was still around. My son, what we did for him, resulted in this view, this next view of the healthcare system in a lot of countries. It's a maze. I left my job in early 2002 to make it my business to help my son live. I took him around the world and found a doctor in Boston at Boston Children's Hospital who said, what we can do is we can create a mismatched bone marrow transplant and we'll give him graft versus host disease, a bad outcome for any bone marrow transplant. But the graft versus host disease will chase away the T cells, and if he can survive the graft versus host disease, he'll live. The story gets even better because what happened was once Eric was cured of his cancer, the rest of the journey was pretty much on our own. Eric was starving from the cure. He couldn't eat. He was cachectic. And we couldn't feed him in a way that allowed him to continue to thrive. I, once I got out of my coma, signed out of the hospital a week later with a neck brace to get home so I wouldn't catch an illness in the hospital. And then the journey was all up to us. Who do we see? How do we cobble together programs? So for me, I use yoga, meditation, cranial sacral therapy, and acupuncture to control what is intractable neuropathy in my left arm. My left arm never stops hurting. I don't take any drugs. My son has gone through a kidney transplant. I gave him my left kidney in 2007. And today, at the age of 29, his cancer is cured. And he's a contributing member of society working in the financial services industry, the only one to ever survive his disease. The important lessons this taught me was that the healthcare system really does not think about the individual being a productive member of society. I was given 7 different narcotics. I was given letters for long-term disability and told I was lucky to be alive, go home, relax, live out the rest of your days. My son was told he would never live, and here he is, a productive member of society. So the system doesn't work. And as I thought about it, we need to make a lot of changes. So we need to disrupt the healthcare system. So I'll put forward a fairly disruptive economic model for both the auto industry and the energy industry. Elon Musk took $190 million out of eBay and put it into rockets and automobiles. And everybody thought he was crazy. The Tesla has an ability now to drive up and down the east and west coast of the United States without having to refuel at cost because of solar-powered charging destinations every 120 miles up and down the east and west coast. And by 2018, we'll be all across the country. The problem is the car costs $100,000. And the big cost is the lithium-ion battery. So Elon has now invested $5 billion in reinventing the lithium-ion battery so he can get his car to a price point of $35,000 so everyone can have an electric car. What will that do to the automobile industry and the energy industry? In healthcare, our lithium-ion battery is the provider system. What can we do to reinvent it? Because now, in the United States alone, 30% is wasted out of $2.7 trillion a year. $810 billion a year is wasted. And the only way we address that issue is to redesign the system so it's focused on a common goal, healthier individuals who are productive, viable, and happy, versus curing sickness. So 4 facts that compel us to change our healthcare system around the world. This is the case for change. The first slide is the impact of chronic non-communicable diseases between 2011 and 2030 around the world. 30.4 trillion US dollars will be consumed by non-communicable diseases. That is 109 trillion reals. That's real money. And our focus on non-communicable diseases as an impact has not been really adequately addressed. We cure the episodic acute illness. We do not think about how to prevent it through wellness. So the idea here is that we need to begin to address these chronic illnesses, which the World Economic Forum now has said will be the second largest driver of the world's economy. Healthcare costs, particularly non-communicable diseases. Here in the region, diabetes is very prevalent. The GCC holds the rank of 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 12th in the prevalence of diabetes. The country with the largest number of diabetics is China, with a number that is almost 5 times that of the United States. So non-communicable diseases are now prevalent across the globe, particularly diabetes. And diabetes is a pandemic that we are all facing and can't begin to understand the impact on our economies of this disease. In 2011, the United States spent billions of dollars inoculating Americans for swine flu to prevent 10,000 to 20,000 deaths, when this disease alone creates that many deaths a week around the world. So how serious are we taking non-communicable diseases? And then third, we keep talking about a shortage of medical professionals. We've talked about the shortage of doctors. Here are nurses and midwives per 10,000 population around the world. Let me ask you this question. Are there a shortage of professionals? Or is there a misalignment of the system in taking care of individuals? In studying the healthcare system, we know one thing. The cheapest place to provide care is in the home, and the cheapest provider of care is the family. The exception should be other venues and other providers beyond the home and the family. So how do we think about providing healthcare in the home? Where are the nurses that we need to do home care? And that balance is going to be really important, because if we just try and educate more professionals and we keep our healthcare system the way it is from a reimbursement standpoint, we will only drive more costs, focus more on sickness, and we'll continue to break the bank around the world. And then fourth, health and medical apps are changing the healthcare landscape. The global market grew by 28% in 2013. There are 1.6 billion global smartphones around the globe. In 2012, 247 million people downloaded health apps. By 2018, this is expected to be 1.7 billion. Why are they interested? Well, for those of you that use a smartphone to access services and information, people want it their way. And I'll give you the new definition for quality in healthcare. It's convenience. For 80% of us, using the healthcare system in a convenient, accessible way is far more important than whether or not my phlebotomist has a PhD. And when you need more complex and necessary care, people want their hands held. So there are two types of patients. There are consumers who are using the healthcare, want it on their own terms, at a cost they can afford, in a place that's convenient for them. And then there are patients who need to have their hand held through the system and guided through the system. When I was being medevaced in my helicopter to Dartmouth-Hitchcock Clinic in New Hampshire, I was not a consumer of healthcare. My health app wasn't going to help me decide how to spend my money. And by the way, the helicopter ride blew me through my deductible and out-of-pocket cost sharing anyway, and so it didn't much matter. I needed people around me that were going to guide me through my care. I needed people that were going to help me understand how to take care of myself, how to get back to healthy. And so these apps that are growing across the landscape are really about how do individuals want to access care. They want it on their terms. They want it in a place that's convenient for them, and they want it to be affordable. And people will find that convenience, and that is the definition of quality for 80% of the population. So, we cannot use the same thinking we've used in the past to fix the problems we have today. Or as Orlando Batista said, an error is not a mistake until you refuse to correct it. And so my first caution to all of you as I talk about the healthcare system of the future is you should not follow the West. Do not build hospitals so that people can come to the hospital. Build systems that meet the needs of the people where they are, in a way that meets their need to be healthier, productive, viable, and happy. So here's a blueprint for the future of the healthcare system. It's around these five components. It's about proper system design, sophisticated technology, which is available in virtually every other industry around the world, care management informed by smart data, aligned economic incentives toward a common goal, and consumer engagement. I'll talk about each of these. First, system design. Building a hospital is not solving a healthcare problem. Building a system built on the needs of a population is. Healthcare should be local. It should be designed around the demography, disease burden, cultural, economic, social, and environmental trends of the population you are serving. You don't need competing health systems. You need one. And if you build it right, you don't need an insurance company. Healthcare should be local. The product people want is their doctor and their health system, not their insurance company. And unfortunately, in the United States, we built a system back in 1946 aimed at bypassing wage freezes by giving people free benefits, and then we created a program called Hill-Burton where we built a bunch of hospitals to give people jobs. And the healthcare system has never been right since. So if you think about a healthcare system where we put the people, the process, and the technology where the community needs it, all with a goal toward making the individual and the community healthier, viable, productive, and happy. And if we did that person by person, community by community, and nation by nation, I think we'd end up with a much better set of circumstances as a human race than we have today. Health IT. Somehow we've checked our brains at the door when we enter the healthcare system by putting our healthcare by putting our technology away. The amount of use for commerce and information technology today is immense and growing every single day. I use it all the time. So one of the things that I'll tell the story is my daughter had to have a certain kind of sweater that she wanted for her birthday, and so she told me where it was in New York, and I went to the store and bought it. But I barcode scanned it first, and it told me who made it. And they asked me if I wanted to see other places where I could buy it, and that showed up on my Google Maps. And then it gave me directions and the phone number to those locations. So I picked the cheapest one. I called ahead, had them hold two. I bought one for Lauren, and I brought the other one to work. I said, why can't we have this in healthcare? Why should people be subject to how the system works versus having the system work for them? And so the technology exists today, and we need to have one view of Mark Bertolini in the system that can be accessed by everybody in the system. And that does not mean that you need to have a single database with all the information for Mark Bertolini in one place. With the broadband that's available today, you need two important things, and here's something that you could all do without having to fight the barriers we fight in the United States and in Western democracy: a single patient identifier and a single provider identifier. And with real node encryption and the broadband we have today, we can get any information about that patient with secure access from the doctor to the place where the doctor needs it, screen through a graphical user interface to get rid of all the extraneous data, to get to the data they need to use for you at that time. And that does not mean we need to digitize all the historical information available about mankind sitting in every provider's office or hospital today. We need the information that's relevant given the patient. So the barriers that stand in the way of doing this is, number one, people believe, providers believe, that the data is theirs. It's not. They believe that it all needs to be digitized before it can be effective. It doesn't. And they don't believe it can be moved around securely. It can. And for those of you who are concerned about privacy, all you need to do is look on social media and spend any time on it, and you immediately can abandon any concern about privacy. The next is care optimization. The care should be about me, and it's not that hard to do. I don't need smoking cessation. I don't smoke. So why offer a wellness program to me that's smoking cessation? What I need is, I need pain management, and I need to learn how to be more active. And I need nutritional advice, and I need help with my yoga and my meditation and all the other things that are important to keep me healthy, productive, viable, and happy. And we can do this. It's not that hard. All we have to do is ask the patient. engage them and make the services available to them and let them do what they want. Ask the patient, advocate for the patient. It is not just the traditional medical programs, it's all of the complementary medicine that can be provided today, because again, I have 7 different narcotics, boatloads of it in a safe at home. I can't give it back, so it sits there. I don't want to put it into the sewer system because it pollutes the water supply. So there it sits. That was my option. That was what the medical system told me they could do for me and my neuropathy to make me healthy, along with a letter for long-term disability. Until I found someone who said, why don't you try cranial sacral therapy, acupuncture, and yoga? And I do. And that's all how I manage my pain. I don't take any pain medication at all. Carry my own needles for acupuncture. I've been there enough times to figure out where they go. And I see a cranial sacral therapist once a week. I'm productive. I'm viable. I'm happy. And so our system needs to be built around a broader footprint that helps people access the services that matter to them. The World Health Organization definition of health, the physical, social, psychological well-being of the individual. Aligned economics. We pay for healthcare all the wrong way. And I'll give you an analogy. I'm a boy from Detroit, grew up in Detroit. And if you were to buy an automobile by saying, I can afford $250 a month, you're not quite sure what kind of car you're going to get. That's confusing the financing decision with the investment decision. The 3 bullet points before, I talked about the investment decision, how to build the right system. The financing of it needs to be separate. But we should pay for it in a way that drives us to the objectives of what the best system is. And so that needs to be a budget, not fee for service. The work we're doing here in Qatar around claims payment shows us that there are abuses even here in the way people charge for healthcare. I can tell you that the GCC nations are paying much higher rates than they need to get care elsewhere around the world. I would argue 25% too much. And so fee-for-service destroys our ability to get to the objective of healthier individuals. So we need to align it around a budget, a single set of costs that the system needs to live within. And if they have to live within a certain budget, then they're going to focus on making sure we take care of the very sickest by holding their hand and getting them through the system more effectively. Investing in wellness, which is a 20-year journey to avoid more people becoming chronically ill, although we'll still have chronic illness. And the two of those together will make room in the system. So payment reform, single budget. Focus on the chronically ill and get them the right kind of care. Improve their access, improve the quality, the costs will take care of themselves. And that makes room for the 20-year investment that you need to make in wellness to prevent people from continuing to get sick. And then engagement. People want it to be easy. They don't want to have to do math. All they want it to do is be easy. And I'll give you an example. We did a pilot on congestive heart failure. 25% of 40%, almost 10% of healthcare dollars in the United States in the Medicare program are spent on congestive heart failure patients over the age of 85. CHF has become a chronic disease. And what we know is that we can monitor this. And so we have 2 pilots going on. The first pilot is we say to the patient when they're discharged, here's a scale with Bluetooth technology, and here are your pills. In the morning, get up, take these pills, and stand on this. You don't need to record anything. You don't need to do any math. You don't need to call anybody. We'll monitor it for you. And if your weight gets out of tolerance, we'll send somebody to your house, who will educate you on your meds. We'll update your meds if they need to be, and we'll roll up the rugs in your house because you've got water weight gain. You shuffle when you walk, you trip and you fall, and you break a hip, and you end up in the hospital. We reduced CHF readmissions by 49%, one of our most expensive admissions. We are now working with Medtronic using their pacemakers to look for vessel impedance in the heart. If the vessel impedance increases, that means water weight gain will be next, and we can actually get further up into the stream of dealing with the patient before they have an incident. So engagement, make it simple, make it easy, make it repeatable. Don't make me have to be a doctor or a professional to understand how to take care of myself. Let the system surround me. And the more we can do of that, the more of that we can do in the home, and the more we can do remotely. So change is happening now around the United States for sure. The Affordable Care Act has been an action-forcing event. It's caused people to talk to one another that would have never talked to one another 3-4 years ago. And it's causing us to think differently about how we align the system. Health system design is important. The retrofit we will have in the West will be significant. You have the opportunity to do it right first. And I encourage you to do health system planning and looking at the population you're serving before you design the people, the process, and technology to provide healthcare. Aligning economic incentives, and then ultimately innovating in wellness programs, making it simple, making it repeatable, making it about me. Those three create a very different model for the future, because we can use the healthcare system then as a driver of economic health for a community and for a nation, instead of a cost that detracts investment from other important factors in our economies. So think about increasing productivity, unlocking consumer spending, because the single biggest threat to the financial viability of most people in the next 20 years will be their health status. Create high-value jobs. Ultimately, improve our budget outlooks in the United States. The next $10 trillion of debt, 75% of it will be driven by Medicare and Medicaid alone. When you include Social Security, it's over 100%. And then we believe that attracts foreign direct investment, because it's a healthier economy with productive individuals and domestic consumption. We believe that the healthcare system designed right can be an economic driver, not a detractor from the capital spend or resources of a community or a nation. So I thank you for your time and attention. I wish you a good evening and a good rest of your conference. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Terrific.
Mark, thank you very much. You've given us a feast of thought to feed on. That's terrific, thank you. It's really important. I kept thinking to myself, it sparked off a whole lot of more thought, which is always the mark of something that is really stimulating. Thank you. We're actually now getting very close to the end of the day. So soon, I hope you'll join me and the WISH team in the reception gallery, which is on the ground floor. Those of you who have signed up to the WISH policy briefings should note they start at 4. Well, it says 4:45, so don't go for a second. Very soon they start. I have to remind you that if you haven't signed up, you won't be able to get in because, as I mentioned earlier, they're oversubscribed. The policy briefings are health affairs in auditorium 1, obesity, auditorium 2, mental health is in room 101, antimicrobial resistance. Got it? I think I deserve a clap for finally getting it. Room, which is in room 6. You won't miss the reception if you do go to those, because when they're finished, the reception will still be continuing. That's if you're going to a policy briefing. Buses will be leaving here from that time, from 6 o'clock onwards, to take you back to where you came from. Just a brief word about tomorrow. There are more of the policy briefings, which start at 8 o'clock here, But those who are not going to the policy briefings, and if you are, it still applies, please be here for 9 o'clock to hear our first keynote speaker of the second day, Dr. Debbie Shetty. Until then, as we heard just now from Mark, I too say have a very good evening. Thanks a lot.